subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
We've been so caught up with silly coronavirus and China that we've forgotten about our favorite subject, which is national politics. So today we take a break from the rest because those two problems are not going to go away soon, and talk about national politics and some very interesting aspects of it. But don't worry, I know all of you want to also stay with China, so, and you like storytelling as well. So in the latter half, I will do a little bit of storytelling, and you will find that China, the borders, the Himalayas, the armies, they will feature again, and it will be quite an interesting story. So first of all, politics. Look at the political map of India. India has 30 states and union territories like Delhi, Pondicherry, which have elected governments. Of the 30, BJP rules 17, either directly or as part of NDA. Of these 17, BJP has its chief ministers in 12 states. Five other states, as we know, Bihar, Nitish is the chief minister, and then there is Sikkim and Mizoram where BJP is hardly present. There is Meghalaya, once again BJP just has a couple of people there, but the ruling party is in coalition with the BJP, and there are other states like that. So leave those aside, BJP has 12 chief ministers of its own. This picture is not as good for the BJP as it was maybe a year or so back when they had many other states, but then they lost some, as we know. So let's not go there. Now look at these 12 chief ministers that the BJP has now and what's happening with them, because therein lies the story of the congressization of the BJP. And what do we mean by congressization? That means the rise of a high command culture. What are the things that we mean when we say congressization of politics, not ideology or anything? Congressization means an all-powerful high command. It also means just a couple of people or one person owning that high command. So essentially one man or a two-man or a two-person rule. Look at the Congress now, Sonia Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi, like that. Three very weak chief ministers and very weak cabinet ministers. So all power then comes down, emanates from one source. So chief ministers increasingly, say at the peak of this congressization, did not even have the power under Rajiv Gandhi, and before that Indira Gandhi in her second phase did not even have the power to appoint even senior level bureaucrats or even district magistrates or collectors or deputy commissioners in key districts. Is the BJP also headed that way? Look for evidence. And the evidence today, and the reason we are talking about this today, is the swearing in of the new cabinet in Madhya Pradesh. Now remember, this isn't quite a new cabinet. Madhya Pradesh BJP chief minister was sworn in on March 24. That's when the BJP brought down Kamal Nath's government. That's when Jyotiraditya Sindhia walked out of the Congress party with 22 of his loyalists, who then defected. They left the Congress party, they joined the BJP, as a result of which they were disqualified from the state assembly. And as we know, that reduced the overall number of seats in the assembly. And so the majority mark became much lower, and BJP then formed a government and defeated Kamal Nath then. Now, what happened? Why do we still call it a new swearing in, a new government being sworn in? Because after Shivraj Singh Chauhan was sworn in, and because BJP did not want the assembly to be suspended because of coronavirus, they kept on pushing it, even while the virus kept spreading in parts of Madhya Pradesh, including the entire health department of Madhya Pradesh government. So Madhya Pradesh was leaderless for a few days and governmentless for a few days while the virus made its inroads there. And then, even after Shivraj Singh Chauhan was sworn in, for almost a month, until 21st of June, and that too after a lot of us in the media had made a lot of noise, until then he was not allowed to swear in any more ministers with him. Then he swore in four ministers. Of the four of those, two were Jyotiraditya Sindhia loyalists. Because why do people defect? People don't defect because their conscience told them to say so, or as we say in the Hindi heartland, antaratma ki pukar. Kisi ki antaratma nahi hai rajniti mein. Aur jo dal badalta hai, one who defects obviously is not responding to any antaratma, any consciousness. A defector is a defector is a defector. You can spell it with a capital D or all capitals, no matter from which party to which party. So these 22 people defected. They all wanted jobs. Now there was a second problem, because if they were to get their jobs, then they had to get elected to assembly again, which means the state will need by-elections, which means all of them have to win. So you also had to calculate who are the ones who are likely to win, who are not the ones who are likely to win again. So again, the calculation comes in, how many of them won the last time on their own and how many had the Congress party vote, etc., etc. So this five-man cabinet continued on for a long time. Now today, after a lot of khichatani, 28 ministers were sworn in. So Madhya Pradesh now finally marched to April, May, June and now July. So 3 months and a week later, it has a full cabinet. But look at these 33 members. These 33 members include 14 of Jyotiraditya Scindia's loyalists. These are defectors. So think about it. It's some kind of a record that 14 members of this cabinet, 14 out of 33, that's a lot of people, that's more than 40% people. 14 out of 33 are not even members of the house yet, and they've all become ministers. Now, if this is the reward for defection, first of all, BJP can no longer call itself the party with a difference. And second, this is congressization of the BJP, because BJP otherwise an ideological party. The basic test of coming to the BJP is, do you believe in our ideology or not? Now, somebody who's opposed your ideology all his or her life comes on board overnight and then becomes a minister, you know what is that person's ideology. And that ideological virus also then comes into the BJP. That is like the Congress virus. So this is the congressization of the BJP. But this is not the only thing that gives us that evidence. Next, of the 33 MLAs, 14 are Scindia loyalists. Of the rest, 6, that is 3 each, are loyalists of Narottam Mishra, who's home and health minister. See, in such a large cabinet, one minister has home as well as health. Home in any case is very powerful, and health right now, because of coronavirus, because of the pandemic situation, is a very high profile and powerful position. So Narottam Mishra is a detractor of Shivraj Singh Chauhan, is also a claimant for the chief minister's job. So he has 3 ministers. Another 3 ministers are loyalists of Kailash Vijayvargiya, who is BJP's very high profile national general secretary, makes headline every now and then about something or the other. He has 3 ministers of his own. He also doesn't particularly love the chief minister. So 6 ministers between them, 14 are loyalists of Scindia, that is 6 and 14, 20. So only 13 of this, if at all, are Shivraj Singh Chauhan and his camp. These include, by the way, one of those interesting facts of Indian politics, these include Yashodhara Raje, who is Jyotiraditya's aunt. She's always been in the BJP. Jyotiraditya was in the Congress. He's come to the BJP now. He's a BJP come lately. But family politics, party politics, vested interests, political rivalries, they cut across not just ideologies, but they also cut across families. Just as they can divide family, they can reunite ideologies, they can also divide families. So she is very much in Shivraj Singh Chauhan camp as things stand now. And where does it leave the chief minister? Shivraj Singh Chauhan was a very powerful chief minister. In fact, we used to say that what brought Narendra Modi to power in 2014 so resoundingly was the fact that the BJP had built very strong chief ministers who could all swing elections in their states for him. So where are those chief ministers now? Vasundhara Raje is gone in Rajasthan. Raman Singh in Chhattisgarh is gone. Gujarat, Narendra Modi himself was there, but he's now come to Delhi. Maharashtra, what happened? It's been 6 years since BJP came to power. Maharashtra hasn't had one senior top leader, in fact, the most powerful and most popular leader of Maharashtra, is sort of sidelined in Delhi, that is Nitin Gadkari, somebody who could swing elections of his own. The only one left of the old stalwarts was Shivraj Singh Chauhan. And Shivraj Singh Chauhan is now cut to size. In fact, I will not even say he's now a lame duck, but you know, to use an Americanism, he is a lame duck who's also been kneecapped. So he can move very little, he can do very little. And you saw it in a very philosophical comment that he made at this swearing in. And it's quite a comment. In fact, you can see a story based on it and built around it by my colleague Neelam Pandey from our political bureau. I will give you a link of that with today's description. And don't worry, today I will not forget to put those in. Last night, many of you reminded me that we'd forgotten and we belatedly put those links in. But today we will not forget. So what did he say? He said, Manthan se sirf amrit hi nikalta hai. That a churning, you remember Sagar Manthan, the legend of Sagar Manthan that Lord Vishnu had presided over. Manthan se sirf amrit hi nikalta hai. Vish to Shivji pi jate hai. Now, I don't know whether he means Shivji as Lord Shiva, or metaphorically, he is also referring to his own name, that is Shivraj Singh Chauhan. So, meaning thereby that I have swallowed this poison, or Lord Shiva swallows the poison, whereas what is left is Amrit. So, you can see that one more BJP leader, BJP chief minister is now cut to size. And once again will be a high command run chief minister. Now look at the rest of BJP's chief ministers. I told you there are 12. We don't have to count all of them. In fact, if I ask you, even those of you who are very well informed with politics will struggle to tell me the names of some chief ministers. So unless you are from these individual states, let me ask you, Himachal, Uttarakhand, who's the chief minister? Goa. Most of you will struggle. In fact, even I might struggle. So just so as not to keep it to myself, Jairam Singh Thakur is Himachal, Pramod Sawant is Goa, and Trivendra Singh Rawat is Uttarakhand, and then smaller northeastern states. So these are chief ministers with no real presence or power or cachet value or the ability even to win their own seats. In one state where BJP repeated its chief minister, Manohar Lal Khattar in Haryana, was a decent fellow. In the second term, because BJP had to put a coalition together, they did not get enough seats because he's a decent fellow, but not really a vote catcher. The election was still fought in the name of Narendra Modi. And people thought that they had already voted for Modi just a couple of months earlier in the national elections. So why must they do it again? So BJP came up with fewer seats, a coalition was built. So this is a case of, I used this earlier, the same Amitabh Bachchan song from Silsila, Khai Gori Ka Yaar Balamtar Se, Rang Bhar Se. So his key portfolios have been given to Dushyant Chautala, who is a coalition partner. And of whatever is left, his authority is divided with his own old detractor, and quite a maverick he is, Anil Vij. Go to his Twitter handle and you will know what I'm talking about. He is a headline a day politician in the BJP. So he's got a lot of authority and power. So again, you are left with a chief minister who is a dead duck that is kneecapped. The same description. So this looks like there is a tendency to cut your chief ministers to size. Then you carry on and look at some of the other states. Look at Karnataka. There are two states in India where BJP still has leaders as chief ministers who are leaders in their own right. One is so strong that he won this position of the chief minister even though his high command did not want to give it to him. That is B.S. Yediyurappa in Karnataka. In fact, I wrote a national interest about it. I'm giving you a link. You can check it out again. Because he defied the high command to be the chief minister, and the high command could not have fought with him because he controls the Lingayat vote in Karnataka. If they get him out, the last time they got him out, he formed his own party. He took away a lot of the vote. Lingayat shifted with him, and in the process, BJP lost power. So that risk they could not take. But reluctantly, obviously, they were not happy that he has taken power from them, which is uncharacteristic of them to let somebody dictate terms to them. they are now cutting him to size. So what's happening right now is that his cabinet is fighting, cabinet members are fighting amongst themselves, and there is no particular discouragement of that or disapproval of that from the high command. So DK Singh, my political editor colleague, he tells me stories of how his health minister B. Sri Ramulu of Ballari fame, his health minister B. Sri Ramulu and his medical education minister DK Sudhakar, Dr. DK Sudhakar. Now this is also a new thing that so many state governments are doing. One man is the health minister, one man is the medical education minister, whatever that means. So these two ministers, they've been fighting with each other and in fact posting figures on the state's coronavirus situation where they contradict each other. So this became a theater of the absurd, to stop which Yediyurappa assigned his education minister Suresh Kumar to become the state government spokesperson on coronavirus. After some time, Suresh Kumar also gave up because he just couldn't handle this daily maramari that goes on in the party. So this has become an indisciplined cabinet there now. Further, if you thought the chief minister was not undermined sufficiently, his high command rejected both his nominees for Rajya Sabha nominations in the state. So both his nominees were rejected. The two members that he was made to send to Rajya Sabha from his state are not the ones he wanted. These are Erana Bhimappa Kadari and Ashok Gasti. Both are known to be the proteges of B.L. Santosh, who's BJP's very powerful leader and general secretary now, very key figure in the RSS. Both are loyal to him, and B.L. Santosh and B.S. Yediyurappa, ask anybody in who watches politics, I don't know how to describe the quote unquote affection between them. Again, there isn't any love lost, if at all, anything. Then you come to Assam, another state that BJP controls. Tell me the name of the chief minister of Assam. But chances are many of you will say Hemanta Biswa Sarma. He's a wonderful man, wonderful politician, very efficient, very effective, but he's the health minister. He has the real power. He is the face of the BJP. Not just in Assam, he's also the face of the Assam government, but he's also the face of the BJP in all of the Northeast. He won the Northeast for the BJP and he controls the party and the governments in the BJP, including his own. So once again, his chief minister is not somebody anybody calls for any help or anything. Everybody knows who's the one who matters. So the same formula, reduce your chief minister into a nobody who gets instructions from Delhi for anything he wants to do. Gujarat, Narendra Modi and Amit Shah's own state, Vijay Rupani, have to be careful saying anything critical about him because some journalist in Ahmedabad said so. He filed a case of sedition against him and locked him up in jail. So nevertheless, Vijay Rupani, it's quite well known that he is remote controlled from Delhi. In fact, the person who runs the government for him is a gentleman called Mr. Kailash Nathan, who is a former IAS officer. He joined Narendra Modi as his principal secretary in 2006. He retired from service in 2013, but since then he's been given 6 extensions and he continues in an innovative designation called Chief Principal Secretary to the Chief Minister. So he's running that state government. And then you come to another state, small government like Manipur. Manipur, BJP begged and borrowed and stole and bought and put together a government. As we know, in the House of 60, BJP had 21, Congress had 19. They were just 2 ahead of Congress. But they got other parties to join in and put Biren Singh as Chief Minister. Now, Biren Singh was getting irritated with number 2 because he took National People's Party, NPP, which won 4 seats there. NPP, by the way, is a party owned by the Sangmas of Meghalaya. They are running Meghalaya. BJP is a junior partner there. BJP just has 2 MLAs in Meghalaya. NPP is the major partner. So, older brother Conrad is the Chief Minister. James Sangma is Home Minister. So their party won 4 seats in Manipur. Those 4 fellows resigned from Biren Singh's government. Why? because Mr. Joy Kumar, who is from that party and who was appointed deputy chief minister in Manipur as part of the deal to make that coalition, he was divested of all his portfolios by an angry Biren Singh. Why? Because he rubbished Biren Singh's claims that there was complete food security in the state by calling it hogwash. Once he did that, Biren Singh took away all his portfolios. He resigned. So all four members of NPP resigned, and then three members of BJP also resigned. When that happened, his government came into a minority. Government was falling. Ibobi Singh of the Congress made claims to form a government. Immediately, he got a visit from the CBI, so that probably shut him up. Meanwhile, BJP got in touch with the Sangmas in Meghalaya, who owned these four MLAs, who then spoke with BJP and made a deal between them. What that deal was, Conrad Sangma has again spoken with Neelam Pandey. See that story, again the link is there. He said basically that one, all the portfolios will be restored to Joy Kumar. Number two, his four MLAs will be in direct contact with the BJP High Command. So anytime they have an issue with the Chief Minister, they'll call the High Command, and High Command has promised them redressal. Number three, there will be a complete overhaul of the Chief Minister's office. So what is left then of the Chief Minister and his authority? Once again, the same story. He might be Chief Minister, but the real power in the state is with these four fellows. And now everybody in his party will also know that there is open season on him, because most of these people are not ideologically BJP people anyway. In fact, a lot of them are formerly of the Congress party. So there is no ideological great linkage also or commitment also. So again, this Chief Minister the same way as the rest. Dead duck, kneecapped, and the power arrangement is the same as elsewhere. Khai guri ka yaar, balam atar se, rang bar se. So, ye rang barasta hai only for as long as the going is good. Because BJP has now got congressized to the extent that all of the BJP, every leader of the BJP, counts on Narendra Modi to get them the votes. It's become a one-man party. To that extent, what in the corporate world is called a single-man risk is now great for the BJP, as it's been for the Congress party. And we've seen what's happened in the Congress party since the Gandhi family has lost its power to get them the votes. They lost their power, in fact, in 1989, and they haven't got it back since then. And since then, the Congress party has been declining. So there are parties which are institutional, which have many centers of power, many leaders. That's the way the BJP was. Now it has changed for better or worse. That's how the BJP wanted to be. So that's our political treatise. I know many of you are fans of Yogi Adityanath, so you will say I am forgetting. He was chosen for the same reason. He was seen as a political lightweight in UP with no real following of his own. But the fact is that the way he's conducted himself, he's now become more of a Hindutva brand ambassador than even Narendra Modi and Amit Shah. So he's a bit more difficult now to shake. So there are exceptions, but he was not chosen to be an exception. He's just turned out to be an exception. And we will see how this game plays out. Because every time somebody says, oh, he could be the successor to Narendra Modi, I think about how these high command led parties psychologically and instinctively respond to these things. Now, I promised you a story in the end, so I'm coming to that. And I'm taking you right back to 1985-86. You have a situation right now in Ladakh. Chinese have come into some territory which they claim to be their own. We claim to be our own. It's not territory that we were controlling actively till now. But there was a gentleman's agreement that India will patrol that area and China will patrol the area beyond that. So Chinese have broken that, and India is now piling up forces to counter it. In 1986, something very similar happened on the other side of the border, in the eastern sector, in Arunachal Pradesh. So go further up from Tawang towards the border with China, there is a small rivulet called Sumdurung Chu. Chu in Tibetan means a rivulet. Sumdurung Chu is where the Chinese came in and pitched camp in 1986 summer. And one patrol from Assam regiment, which went there on one of its regular patrols, discovered the Chinese were there. They've set up a post. They came back and reported. It caused a lot of tension in Delhi. I will not tell you the story in detail. In fact, I will give you the link to a piece that Nainima Basu and Srijan Shukla have done for the print. We have a wonderful series called Past Forward, when we revisit some earlier important stories, and through archival research and talking to players, we put that story together, particularly when that story becomes relevant today. So Rajiv Gandhi was Prime Minister then. There was an immediate reaction. India also had a very, very aggressive army chief. It's rare to have those in India. This was General Krishnaswamy Sundarji, who decided to challenge it and who said, I will not accept it. Although there were many in the establishment, diplomatic and political establishment, who said, don't take panga with the Chinese, we are not ready yet. But he said, nothing doing. So he moved a brigade, and then there was no road going beyond Tawang. So he used the new Mi-26 heavy lift helicopters of the Indian Air Force to lift an entire brigade to a feature called Zimithang, which was way out of Tawang, much closer to Sumdrungchu. And then he had his troops go and take up the heights on a ridge called Hathungla. Now this reversed the equation of 1962, because this is the same Thagla Ridge, Namkachu area in general, where the first disasters, or the biggest disaster of the 1962 war, took place. That's where the war started. But this time he went and he put his troops on the heights. Earlier the Chinese had the high ground there. Now he got himself on the high ground in the same area. And you know what a coincidence it was? The dates on which he did this was between 18 October to 22nd October. Remember, 20th October is when, in 1962, that the Chinese attacked Indian positions, or the war started. So at that point, discounting that history, no Vastu, no numerology, no Shubdin, Ashubdin, he moved a brigade there, and Chinese had not expected a brigade to move in so quickly. And when that came in, Chinese started scrambling to bring their own forces. As they brought in their own forces, General Sundarji further ratcheted up. He then took up his entire 5th Mountain Division and put them ahead to defend Tawang. Now there's a little history behind that. In 1962, China has first taken Tawang quite easily. Then from Tawang, they went towards Bomdila. So the most defensible feature between, say, the border of China there and the plains of India is Sela, which is high, it's a massive, you can defend it well. That's where India had set up its defenses in 62 that crumbled. So once again, the idea was that Tawang itself is not defensible. So in case of a war with China, the Chinese come in, India will abandon Tawang and withdraw and fight them at Sela, but this time fight them resolutely and credibly and defeat them there and bog them down there. But when Mrs. Gandhi came back to power in 1980, she was once again reviewing India's strategic environment, etc., because Janata government was not very strong in those areas, plus it was too weak a government. In 1981, another fine general took over as chief of Indian Army Staff, that is General K.V. Krishna Rao. He discussed this with Mrs. Gandhi, the situation on these borders, and Mrs. Gandhi said to him that, look, General, Tawang must not fall. Tawang must never fall. So do something now so we can move forward and defend Tawang, no matter what the topography is and no matter what the geography of the area is. So General Krishna Rao agreed with this, and that's when Indian armed forces started patrolling up to Hathungla and beyond. Otherwise, they would not even have known the Chinese had come into Sumdrungchu. Later, Sundarji then took that strategy to its logical conclusion. Just one of those happy coincidences. Both Krishna Rao and Sundarji came from Mahar regiment. So salute to the Mahars, one of the most wonderful regiments of Indian Army. So Krishna Rao started the patrolling. So a patrol of Assam rifles discovered this place, and this Assam regiment patrol was led by a young captain called Captain Ashish Das. In fact, our reporters have spoken with Colonel Ashish Das, the rank at which Captain Ashish Das retired, And he repeated the story to them, recounted the story to them. It's also a fact that the height that he saved because of his patrol is even now called Ashish Top on Indian Army's maps. And he lives in Kolkata now. So once the patrol discovered it and Sundarji responded so strongly, Chinese responded, Deng Xiaoping actually made a statement that India deserves to be taught another lesson, but India stood firm. So first, the first operation of moving forces up to Hathungla was called Operation Falcon. After Operation Falcon, instead of pulling back, General Sundarji further built up through an exercise called Exercise Checkerboard, and effectively he brought the entire frontier to life and challenged the Chinese. And Chinese also then once again brought in hundreds of pieces of artillery and tanks and all kinds of heavy stuff, but also realized that a full-scale war was going to be problematic. It was in that situation, slowly by May of 1987, that things began to calm down. But in the middle, Government of India did something else. That's why sometimes to think that Government of India has only now become firm with China or has always been weak with China is wrong. Because while this was going on and China was piling up its forces on our borders in Arunachal and elsewhere and was looking much more warlike than even now, except there was no violence, India, as soon as 1987 started, announced full statehood for Arunachal Pradesh. Till 1972, it was a centrally administrative territory called NEFA, Northeastern Frontier Agency. Now, then it became Union Territory. Now, while the Chinese stood there, India announced that it's a full state of the Indian Union. That got the Chinese even more angry, and standoff became sharper for the next few months, but then things began settling down. Nevertheless, the two sets of troops stood there eyeball to eyeball for a very long time. It took India and China a full 9 years to bring about a resolution. So both sets of forces came back and they got out of that eyeball to eyeball situation. So once again, India is used to handling these things in the past, and India has not given in. It has handled these things well. You want to read more about it? I think you have to source some of General Krishna Rao's books. Three books of his I know about. 1991, Study of National Security. Number two in 2001, In the Service of the Nation, Reminiscences. And number three in 2011, Invincibility, Challenges and Leadership. There's another article about him, that his son, KVL Narayan Rao, who was a wonderful man, CEO of NDTV, he wrote about him. And that article also mentions one more incredible story from his life. General Krishna Rao, after retirement, was governor of Kashmir. And on 26th of January 1995, he was taking salute at the parade in Jammu when three bombs were thrown. Three bombs went off. Several people died. By God's grace, he survived unscathed. He stood there. There were lots of demands that governor should resign in response to this failure. But you know what he said? I asked him at Jammu and Kashmir Bhavan, at Kashmir Bhavan in Delhi, and he indulged me quite a bit. So I asked him, sir, there were lots of demand for you to resign. So he said, look, I'll tell you something which you can go and write, that this is Kashmir. We are facing an insurgency. Things like this will happen. Bombs will be thrown. Governors, generals, politicians, anybody will be assassinated. If after every terror incident, the governor of the state has to leave, has to resign, then you will have to find many more governors at a very quick pace for Kashmir. So in fact, I used it then in my article by saying that if that logic applies, then Kashmir will have to change as many governors, so we'll have to change them as frequently as the Indian hockey team does after every debacle. So this was a good opportunity for us also to remember a great soldier.